multiple time dimensions. What role are they? None, as far as I'm aware, but I'm also aware that this is not a very studied why do conscious brains, why do we perceive time moving forward? Well-defined question, but also one that I think we do not really not really study, and for good or ill, do not spend time thinking about.
Yeah, maybe just to say something related to what I have been thinking about. I mean, so in some sense, a lot of what I have been thinking about has been the relationship between the Euclidean signature and the Minkowski signature theories, which in some sense you can think of, it's the difference between having zero time dimensions, I mean, just four space dimensions, and one time dimension. And anyway, I think there's a lot of amazing mathematical structure there. Just thinking about four dimensions, about this relation between zero time and one time, the thing, and how this works out with spinners and twisters and everything. The one thing kind of bothers me a little bit, that I still don't know what to think about, is that if you look at the possibilities in four dimensions, you know, because you have your choice between what's, you know, in the metric signature, what's positive, what's negative, but you basically got three possibilities. You basically got kind of zero time dimension, so all four positive or all four negative, and you've got, which is where things are kind of nice mathematically, or you've got one time dimension, which is one positive or one negative. And that seems to be where we live, and that's Minkowski space-time. But there's also this possibility of two positives and two negatives, to have this split signature of signature 2-2 in four dimensions. And that in some sense, the whole story about spinners and reality and everything actually works most nicely in that story. So everything I'm thinking about, there's clearly a story happening over there in this split signature. But it, as far as I know, it has nothing to do with the real world. And again, it's this problem of, you know, if you're purely thinking about mathematical beauty, I'm very tempted to go think about that 2-2 signature case. But I just can't see any possible conceivable relation to any question about the real world that I know about. And someday somebody may tell me one. But anyway, that's the only way this topic has come up in my own thinking.
There's something I'd just like to put in, which I kind of wanted to say, is about the kind of relation between hype and then ultimate intellectual substance. I mean, it's, even if there is, you know, some hype-ridden press release about something that isn't a kind of a, you know, that isn't really very, very substantial, that doesn't take away from, you know, the existence of, you know, the actual subject, the actual is an intellectual coherent thing. The existence of things. Peter was referring earlier, I think we're both complete in agreement about, for example, like mirror symmetry. There are lots of these things which are just there, and they're correct, and they're lasting, and they're extremely deep. I mean, areas of mathematics, for example, there are areas which, you know, for example, like finite group theory is one of these areas where at one point there was a lot of work, and then I think the subject basically was exhausted because all finite groups were classified. And yeah, that doesn't mean the fact that there aren't lots of new results in finite group theory is not a criticism of the kind of the intellectual value or validity of it. It's just that sometimes, you know, you find some things out which are really deep and profound, and you find them out, and they're true, and they're still just as intellectually deep and profound. So, I mean, I am very strong in my defense of the intellectual value and long-lasting validity of string theory. As you said, I'm much more nuanced about whether everything right now is kind of optimized for an environment that creates maximal progress, but my defense of the underlying theory itself is completely unqualified.
Peter, how much of your criticism towards string theory would be removed if string theory was classified as mathematics and not mathematical physics?
I completely. This is the thing that actually drives me nuts: is when people say that, oh. I see all these people criticizing string theory and saying, oh, you know, the problem with it, it's just it's actually mathematics, it's not physics. And that's just, I mean, no, it's not mathematics. I mean, mathematics has, this is not, you know, interesting things that come from string theory, but anyway, the problem is kind of what people mean, maybe to... I have my own views, which I've been kind of accused of being kind of semi-mystical, in the sense that I believe that deep physics and deep mathematics are heavily intertwined and are in some sense maybe even will turn out to be the same thing. So it's not, anyway, don't know how to say this, but maybe I'm going in the wrong direction with this, but the just to say that the thing that I really dislike hearing is saying that, oh, you know, the problem with string theory is that it's mathematics, not, it belongs in mathematics environments, or what's, and it's just, if you look at something like ADS-CFT, there just isn't any particularly deep mathematics there. That does not belong in a math department. Mathematicians might be able to tell you something, but you know, it's an idea about physics, and it needs to stand your liver stand as an idea about physics. And it's true of a lot of string theory. And the things, I mean, there's a complicated relation, but this idea that string theory is just mathematics, that's really kind of a wrong way of thinking about it, because it's not. I mean, mathematicians have our field has its own structure and its own way of doing it. And this is no mathematician would say that this is true. Oh yes, you know, string theory is just, you know, a natural part of math departments. That's really not the way the way things are.
I think often people start off when they're young and they're good at stuff, but then there is a very big cultural difference between maths and physics. And I think Ed Whitten is one of the very few people who's really been able to speak both languages almost like as a native speaker. I think most people are either physicists or they're mathematicians, and there's actually quite a deep cultural difference between the two.
Yeah. No, I think it's been one of the great fascinations of my life to see both communities there is a kind of, I think, a fascinating relation between the two. They are very different. They have different histories. They have very different ways of thinking about things. But I think they are also in some ways deeply related. And it's a fascinating subject to see the interrelation between the two. But the idea that the problem with string theory is just that it's been improperly categorized and should be mathematics is just wrong-headed.
Well, speaking of mathematicians and physicists, a large portion of this audience are either professors or academic researchers in math and physics, and then another large portion are people who are becoming researchers. So, Joe, what's your advice to young researchers, people entering the field? I'm sure you'd want to skip the existing researchers.
To learn whatever part of the subject you want to learn it properly. So try and avoid the kind of popular science books and learn quantum field theory properly, learn GR properly, then that gives you the position to make, you know, informed intellectual decisions about, you know, what you really want to study. And in terms of research, I think, you know, try and, yeah, just to echo famous advice by Weinberg, you know, try and be in areas that are messy rather than areas that are clean.
Peter?
Well, I mean, one category of student I often get to meet and talk to are people who are interested in both math and physics. And and the standard kind of advice I give them is at least in the U.S., the U.S. job situation that I'm most familiar with, if you kind of can't decide between the two and you like doing both, you probably should go to graduate school and try to have a career in mathematics. You're going to do it's a lot easier environment. You know, the kind of ratio between really really smart people and, you know, jobs where you can actually, you know, do think about what you want to think about is much better in mathematics. So that's a little bit of just kind of practical advice. It's very hard, you know, I think it's a very tough situation for students who really, you know, understand very well, you know, they're in love with the questions about fundamental physics. They want to figure out how to do something with this, how to make their way. You know, it is very, very tough. And the situation in, you know, getting a PhD in theoretical physics, trying to find a job is quite difficult. I don't necessarily that I have really good advice.
It's an extraordinary privilege to be able to think about these areas, and right. You know, the worst thing that can happen is someone has to kind of like quadruple their salary by going and working, leaving the subject and going working somewhere else. So Yeah.
Yeah. I should say also that, you know, seeing what's going on with students these days, I mean, most of them are kind of very worried about and thinking about, you know, what's going on with AI and what's going on their own. It's quite possible that we're going to be, you know, we're on the cusp of these kinds of research and these kinds of fields changing quite a lot because in some ways driven by AI, if only whether or not for intellectual reasons, but if only that's where all the money is coming from. And so, you know, I mean, mathematicians are very much, I don't know how much effect this is having in physics. Mathematicians are very much starting to debate, you know, the standard ways in which we've done mathematics research in terms of, of writing proofs and checking proofs. You know, should we start being using automated theorem checkers or provers, or, you know, in some sense, mathematics research looks like it's something that AI might actually really be able to do. It's possible it can do it as well as or better, or it can teach mathematics probably better than the rest of us. So what's going to happen there? So I'm curious if Joe has any, if you see this in physics also, what is the AI going to have impact on people's careers?
I don't have I do feel that at undergraduate level, we need to have a very clear, you know, there needs to be a very clear thing as to the traditional, you know, there's an awful lot of calculations you do by hand. Yeah. So it's important to understand how calculations work, but I think one has to kind of revisit all this and think, is this in the same way we don't use slide rules, we have calculators, and think about, as we're training people for the future, are, you know, learning how to do complicated integrals by hand, is this the right skill set? Perhaps it is, perhaps it's not, but to think about, yeah, in terms of solving problems, whether, yeah, we need to just kind of, yeah, the old methods are still the right ones, but I don't have a clear answer.
To stay informed in an ever-evolving landscape, I see The Economist as a wellspring of insightful analysis and in-depth reporting on the various topics we explore here and beyond. The Economist's commitment to rigorous journalism means you get a clear picture of the world's most significant developments, whether it's in scientific innovation or the shifting tectonic plates of global politics. The Economist provides comprehensive coverage that goes beyond the headlines. What sets The Economist apart is their ability to make complex issues accessible and engaging, much like we strive to do in this podcast. If you're passionate about expanding your knowledge and gaining a deeper understanding of the forces that shape our world, then I highly recommend subscribing to The Economist. It's an investment into intellectual growth, one that you won't regret. As a listener of TOE, you get a special 20% off discount. Now you can enjoy The Economist and all it has to offer for less. Head over to their website, www.economist.com/TOE, T-O-E, to get started. Thanks for tuning in. And now back to our explorations of the mysteries of the universe.